that's above all names. His name is Jesus. We're going to sing a lot about him. Come on. Come on, let's sing it out. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of Sing about that. We can declare that I will build my life upon His love. It's a firm foundation. We're not shaken in His love, right? So good. Man. Are we going to talk about the elephant in the room right now? I got this new hat. I've really been digging it lately. So yeah, I broke my collarbone. Really hurt. It's fine. It's cool. There's three ways I could have done it, though. And it's up to you. It's whatever story you want to tell yourself. So I was skydiving and the chute didn't open like it should have. That's option one. Option two, the building was burning. I knew the kittens were in there. I was like, I got to get them. I got them. They have all their fur. The third option would be that a grown man tried to ride a skateboard. So I'm never skydiving again. And here's the deal. There's a sound that I love pretty much more than anything in this whole world. That's a baby laughing. The second sound that I love more than anything in the world is the people of God singing songs to the glory of God. I think there's just something so majestic about it. And I think the two go hand in hand because I think a baby laughing is just pure joy. They don't know what's wrong, right? They just laugh. Just laugh. And when the people of God sing songs to God, I believe it's the closest we get to what heaven feels like. All right? And so we're just going to do that. We're going to do that for the next few minutes. And so, Lord Jesus, in this place, would you be glorified in such an amazing way that we leave this room tonight and we go like, I don't even know what happened. The only way I can describe that is just God himself. And he did something amazing. And so, Lord, that's our prayer that you would do something crazy tonight. For your glory, not for our benefit, but just for your glory to show off. And it's in Jesus' name. We love y'all. Welcome to CrossPoint.
It's not- we don't do this often because all the glory goes to God, but can we just show some gratitude to the band and to the team here? Thank you, guys. And the reason I do that is they have sung and played with an intensity all day today around this idea that He is our living hope. And the reality is, I don't know that I always live with that same intensity. Like, I know that He's my living hope, and yet I still put my hope in other things. And maybe you do too. Maybe that's also your story. And those things have always let me down. And like, eventually they prove to be not enough. And sometimes I forget that Jesus is a present tense God. He's not a past tense God. We read the Bible and we read about what He did, but that's not where He stayed. He didn't stay in the grave. He is our living hope. He is active and present in our lives. And He is safe enough to be our living hope. We can anchor ourselves in Him. He's a firm foundation. We sang it for three songs. Now the test comes in moving out of the song and living it. But that's all of our challenge, to really believe that for ourselves. And so that's my prayer, Jesus. Would you help me believe that in a whole new way, Father, that I would anchor this week in You as my living hope, in the meetings that we're going to have, in the conversations we have to have, in the difficult decisions we have to make, in the things that scare us and the things that intimidate us, in the areas of our life where we feel out of control. You are a firm foundation. You can handle all of that. So, Jesus, would You be our living hope? I pray that we'll all have the opportunity to walk that out in a fresh way and with an intensity. And if we need a little help, we can find the songs and we can put them on the week and get a little reminder of what we experienced together. And what we experienced together is Your presence, Father. And we want to stay close to that all week long. So we ask that You'll be our living hope, Jesus. And it's Your name that we pray this. Amen. Amen. All right, you guys can have a seat. Hey, welcome to CrossPoint 5:30. We're so glad you're here. We've been excited to see you all day long. And my name's Chris. I'm the Nashville campus pastor. I love getting to be here with you. If you're new here, CrossPoint's a place where everyone's welcome, where nobody's perfect, and where anything's possible. And that's good news, because if you've had a bad experience with church before, or if you've had struggles with God, I just want to tell you, this is a safe place where you can re-engage, you can try again. And we're really glad that you're here. Hope that you have a great experience. And once you're here for a little while, we'd love for you not just to be an attender here, but to be a part of this place. I recognize I often stand up here and welcome all the new people, but some of you aren't new. You've been here for a while, but maybe you feel like you're on the sidelines. There is a part for you to play. All of us get to play a part in His kingdom. And it's really easy to take a step. If you want to get more involved than just attending, you can go to crosspoint.tv/everyone's welcome. And on that site, you'll see all kinds of different opportunities. And the key is really to find the one that's right for you, that's connected to something you're passionate about, to something that you'd enjoy being a part of. And then when you click through, it's going to connect you with one of our staff, one of our volunteers. We'd love for you to be a part of one of our teams and a part of what God is doing at CrossPoint. We'd love for this not just to feel like the church that you attend, but to feel like your church. And so that's one of the ways you can do it. So I'm going to invite our greeters to come forward as we receive our offering today. You know, when we give, we don't do so out of obligation. God doesn't require that of us. He gives it as an opportunity. We believe here that everything is given to us by God, that He is the provider. We give a portion back because it gives us the opportunity to play a part in what He's doing in the world. And we hear all kinds of stories here and see a lot of examples of what God is doing in Middle Tennessee and throughout the world through your giving and through your generosity. But one of the great things I love about God is He doesn't just give us that opportunity through giving. He also gives us the opportunity through serving, through giving some of our time, some of our energy, to be a part of what He's doing in the world. And one of the things I love about this church is that you guys serve all the time, that every week of 2019, there's some sort of service project happening and people serving out in the community. But we dial that up a couple times a year and we do it really big. And that's happening this Saturday. It's called Serve the City across all five of our campuses. We'll spread out across Middle Tennessee. We'll serve our neighbors with no strings attached. And we do it because we think it's a great way to tell people and to show people that God loves them. And so yeah, you can applaud for that. If you clap, you have to sign up. It can't just be a good idea. No, we got so many projects this week where we're just going to try and just tangibly show people that we love them. And so there's three different schools that we're going to go serve. We love the way that schools serve our kids. We want to show them that we're proud of them, that we love them. You've heard probably we're launching a new campus on the north side of town. We haven't launched it yet, but we can start being the church before we have church. And so we've got multiple projects going up on the north side. I know one of the cool ones I think is in Gallatin. It's called the Shalom Zone. It's this organization doing all kinds of incredible work. They got a food pantry, a clothing closet. They've got GED classes. They've got so many things. We're just going to find a bunch of ways to help them out and to partner with them. And then, like, if you live in Antioch, we're part of the Good Neighbor Festival. We're going to be back at the Highlands Apartments. There's a lot of projects. And the key is really just to find the one that sounds fun to you, works with where you live or with your schedule. And I'll tell you, this is the best way you can spend a few hours on a Saturday morning. Because, hey, we're all college football fans, and let's be real, we don't know how the game's going to go. So let's really have a great Saturday morning to set the tone for the rest of the day. So it's really easy if you want to be a part of Serve the City. You can go online, sign up at crosspoint.tv/local, or if you'd rather make it a little more personal, talk to some of our volunteers in the lobby. Look for the red balloons, the red t-shirts. They can help you get plugged into a project. And I love this week. I love the stories we hear coming out of Serve the City. Speaking of stories, we are continuing in our series called Over It. We're talking about these areas of our life where we're fed up, but we want to move from fed up to freedom. And what we're talking about tonight is the idea of comparison, something I would imagine all of us have had to deal with at some point. And my friend Nicole was kind enough to share some of her story, and she did so in the form of a letter that she wrote to Comparison. So check this out.
Dear Comparison, you and I have had quite the battle the last 15 years. And you know what? It's time we address how I'm tired of fighting. It's funny how moments that impact you so deeply are rooted in your memory. Growing up in one of the most affluent areas in the Pacific Northwest, you were a concept that was talked about openly with groups of friends. And someone would always launch into a statement like, "Did you see so-and-so got a brand new car? Did you hear so-and-so move to a bigger house on the lake?" I didn't realize how you were manipulating how I looked at myself. One of the strongest holds you had on me was in my sophomore year of high school. I had just left high school youth group and realized I'd forgotten something in the building. As I walked back to grab it, I overheard one of the leaders say, "Nicole's great. She's committed, loves the Lord, but ultimately, she doesn't have the influence we need her to have to be a strong leader." In comparison, we know these three girls have a stronger influence, and we should ask them to lead. Comparison, in this small moment, you made me feel so small. You ended up costing me wonderful opportunities, relationships, and true spiritual growth for many years. But you know what? I'm done. For too long, you have robbed me of joy. And today, I make a promise to no longer let you have control over my life. I am strong, I am capable, I am worthy. I'm excited to finally be rid of you. I look forward to investing in relationships where I don't pick myself or the other person apart. Comparison, you may have been a part of my past, but I refuse to allow you to be a part of my future. And that future, it's going to be beautiful. Sincerely, Nicole.
Thank you, Nicole. It's such a powerful, powerful story. And the lie that comparison told Nicole was that you don't have influence, but yet you see what God did. He used her life to influence thousands. And Nicole, I just want you to know your life and your story and your brave your ability to tell your story has influenced thousands and the hundreds of college students that you serve. She serves in our college ministry here at CrossPoint, and I'm so grateful for you and the way that you shared that. In this series, we're talking about how do we get over these things, and so today we're going to talk about comparison, but in order to get there, I got to tell you a story, and I've only had a gun pulled on me once in my life. Right now, you're wondering, do you laugh or do you tell, like... And so let me tell you a story. It was back when I worked for my dad, and I was the vice president of marketing for Foundation Technologies, and there were only six employees, and we were all vice president of something, but I was VP, right out of college, VP status, and it's my job to go do these engineering seminars. So I went to Birmingham to do an engineering seminar, and I was in Mountain Brook doing this engineering seminar. I was staying at the Holiday Inn there, And it was early one morning, we were going to have to set up the deal, and I get a knock at the door super early, it's still dark outside, and I'm thinking maybe it's a coworker trying to wake me up. And so I go to the door, and I look out a little peephole and didn't see anybody out there. And so I'm like, man, well, my coworker's messing with me. So I open up the door to say something, and when I open up the door, a guy comes around the door, and he's got a bandana pulled up over his face, hood pulled up, and a gun in my face. And at that moment, I didn't know what to do. And so I take the door, and I push on the door to slam it. Well, his hand was coming into the room. So I push on the door, and I start screaming like a little girl. I mean, I'd love to say I said something tough, but I didn't. I was just like, no, get out, no, get out. Like three octaves just higher than it should have been. I'm screaming. His hand, the gun is right here next to my face, and I'm pushing with everything I've got. And so then I'm like, well, I've got to slam the door again. So I take the door back, and I go to slam it again. At that moment, he pulls his hand out, and then I shut the door, lock the door. I go over, I'm shaking. I call the police. I call the front desk. I call my wife. I call everybody I can think of, trying to figure out what to do. And it was one of those moments, like it just, when I tell that story to people and I tell them about what happened in Birmingham, they're like, are you kidding? Like Mountain Brook is the nicest part of Birmingham. I wouldn't know. I haven't been back. Like I have no interest. I'll trust you. Trust you on that. But that experience, it changed me. Like it changes the way that I open doors in hotels. Now when I open a door in a hotel room, I'm like a ninja. Like just like, watch out. I mean, it just changes. It changes the way I read scripture. I read this verse in Genesis chapter 4. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Genesis chapter 4, verse 6, it says, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. You get that picture? Like sin is crouching at your door and it wants to take you out. Sin is right there around the door and it wants to master you. And unless you master it, unless you rule over it, it will rule over you and take you out. Now, what's the sin that he's talking about in Genesis chapter 4? Well, who is God talking to? He's talking to Cain. He's talking to Cain and he says this to Cain right before he kills his brother Abel. But what is the sin that God is talking about? The sin that God's talking about is envy. The sin that God is talking about is jealousy. See, Cain was envious of his brother's offering to God. He was jealous of his brother's favor with God. And so God said, you know the right thing to do, but instead you're living in envy and that sin is crouching outside your door and it desires to take you out. And you got to rule over it or else it will rule over you. And I think we hear that in the context of envy, and we're like, we kind of take a pass because we're like, well, envy's not that bad. Like we think, well, envy's not. Listen, I've been a pastor for a long time, and the one sin, I've had people confess a lot of sin. Just about any sin you can think of, people have confessed to me, but the one sin that nobody's ever confessed to me is the sin of envy. Nobody's ever came and said, Pastor, can you pray for me because I'm really jealous of somebody else. Nobody's ever confessed envy. Confessed a lot of other sin, but and I think it's because we think that because envy is in here, that it doesn't affect life out there. Because envy and jealousy are an inside job, we think, well, it doesn't affect other people. We think, well, we're more sophisticated than Cain. We're not going to kill Abel. But what the scripture says is that envy kills us. Look at what scripture says in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30. It says, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Picture is what envy does in here is it literally consumes us from the inside out. It eats us up on the inside, our gratitude and our joy and our love and relationships, that envy destroys us from the inside out. But it's not one that we think is that harmful, because I think for many of us, when envy knocks, when envy comes to the door and knocks, it doesn't pound at the door. It sounds like a friend. See, when envy knocks, the knock is comparison. Like, just look over there. Look what they got. Like, look at their car. Now look at what you got. Look at their house. Now look what you got. Look at their family. Look at their spouse, their wife, their husband. Look at their kids. Look at their kids' school. Look at their clothes. Look at their popularity. Look at their fame. Look at their success. Look at their status. Look at their awards. Look at their pool. Now look at your not pool. Look back at their pool. You don't have a pool. Like, I mean, just look. And what comparison does is it's us looking at what other people have and what we don't have. And so when envy knocks, it shows up as comparison. And because it's a harmless knock, oftentimes we open up the door. And rather than evict it, we entertain it. And when those thoughts come in, we just begin to think those thoughts and we think, it doesn't really affect us because it's on the inside. I don't know what that dude thought he was going to get. I had $38 in my wallet and a Chili's gift card. Like, that's all I had going for. I had 12 boxes of engineering binders, technical specifications for our products. Like, surprise, sucker, here you go. Like, I mean, I don't know what he thought he was going to get, but I know what envy wants to take from you. Wants to take your joy, wants to take your contentment, wants to take your appreciation for the life that you have, wants to take your peace. Like, envy wants to destroy your heart. Jesus said, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But he says, I've come that you might have life and have it to the full. I've come that you would have abundant life. Envy wants to rob abundant life, and it just knocks. Envy knocks at the door, and rather than saying, no, get out, no, get out, three octaves lower, rather than doing that, we just entertain it. We let it come in. So envy knocks, and it's when that person at work gets the opportunity that you wanted, and so you despise them just a little, and you secretly hope they fail, and you talk behind their back. The person at the gym has the physique that you want, you know, the muscles that you want, you know, the traps that you want, and the tries that you want, and the abs that you want, and you see that, and you envy them just a little. So you find a flaw in their personality to make you feel better about yourself? All right, we're getting real today. Or somebody that you envy has a minor setback in life, and you feel this slight tinge of pleasure because of the difficulty they've experienced. Anybody, that ever happened to you? No, me neither. So there's a knock at the door. When you're looking through Instagram and somebody that you're jealous of, you see what they post, and it makes you feel that jealousy, so you screenshot it, and then you send it to a friend with a snarky comment. Oh, okay, that was a confession. All right, we're good. Now we got, we're talking. Or when somebody gets the success that you want, or the gig that you want, or writes the number one song, or somebody goes and their book is a success, or somebody's more well-known, or they get the award, and all that's going on, and then this thing stirs inside of you, and so you criticize it just because they got what you wanted. And that list wasn't hard to come up with. You know why it wasn't hard to come up with? Because I've talked to you, I'm just kidding. Because we all struggle with this. We all struggle with this. And unless we're honest in our confession, then we won't know how to evict envy when it shows up. And instead, we'll entertain it, and it'll eat us up on the inside. And the truth is, we want to make it about the other person when it's not about the other person. Because it's not about the other person, because there's always going to be another person. We realize that, right? There's always going to be another person who's richer and taller and skinnier and smarter and more talented and better looking and have more hair and more abs and more success. So we realize that it's not about the other person. It's about us. And it's about what's going on in our heart. And so how do we get free of this? The challenge is it's easier to see envy in other people than it is ourselves. Like, we can see when somebody else is envy of other people, but it's hard to see it when it's in ourselves. I was having lunch with a friend down in Germantown, and I was leaving the restaurant, and I saw my brother-in-law, Zach, and I saw Zach, I run over to Zach, and he lives in the east side of town, so I was like, Zach, what's up? And I'm like, I'm going to take a picture with Zach, and then I'm going to send it to my wife, my sister-in-law. So I took this picture. Zach is so much cooler than me. And so I took this picture with Zach, and I sent it to my wife and my sister-in-law, and I was like, guess who I saw? And I thought it'd be really cool, but I didn't get, like, a response from them. But I thought, man, this is great. I saw Zach, and I was just so excited all day because I just saw Zach in town. And so I get to the end of the day and get done with that, and go watch Camden run track, and I'm sitting up in the stands, sit with my 15-year-old daughter, Raleigh, and I'm like, hey, guess who I saw today? She said, who? I saw Uncle Zach. She said, okay. And she wasn't as excited. And so, but I showed her the picture. She's like, oh, that's good. And then she's looking at the picture. And she said, Dad, you have something in your teeth. And she zoomed in. And I was like, it's like I do have something in my teeth. Take that down. And I said, I do. And she said, look at me. And I look over. My 15-year-old daughter said, Dad, you have something in your teeth still right now. And so she helps me get it out of my teeth. And then I'm thinking, why didn't anybody tell me? That guy I had lunch with, he didn't tell me. Zach didn't tell me. I had 4 meetings that afternoon. Do I not have any friends? If you want to know the truth about yourself, have a 15-year-old daughter. And if you want to know the truth about yourself, ask God. Because he can see the things about you that you can't see. Ask God. Remember what God said to Cain? He said, why is your face so downcast? Cain, you can't see your face, but I can see your face. Cain, why is there so much anger going on? It's because of envy and jealousy and comparison with your brother. God can see the things about you you can't see. This is why one of the most brave and powerful prayers you can pray is in the Psalms. David prayed it. Psalm 139, verse 23. He says, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. David's like, God, would you search my heart? Would you look inside? I can't see in here. I can't see the envy and the jealousy and the comparison on my own. God, I need your help to see what's going on in here. My heart is wicked. God, I've got these thoughts going on in here. God, I need you to help me see the truth about me. I want to know the truth about me, God, so that you can help change my life. God, so would you reveal it to me? And then would you lead me in the everlasting way? God, would you lead me in a better way to live? I know envy is going to rot me from the inside out. Would you lead me to a heart of peace? It'll be like life. God, would you give me that? So with that as the prayer, we're going, okay, how do we find the better way? And then we're reading in Philippians where Paul gives us the better way. The book of Philippians, remember, Paul is writing it from a prison cell. Paul is writing it in prison for preaching the gospel. And as he's writing it, it'd be easy for him in jail to struggle with comparison, to look at all the people who are outside, all the people who have more freedom, who have more possessions, all the people who are eating better food, all the people who are living the life that he would want to live, living outside. It'd be easy for him to live in a place of comparison, locked down in there. It'd be easy for Paul to be at a place saying, God, you know what? I did the thing you wanted me to do. All I've ever done is live for you. All I've ever done is wanted to serve you and love you and honor you with my life. And this is what I get. God, this is what I get. I get jail when everybody else has freedom. It would be so easy for Paul to live in a place of comparison, but instead, Paul lives in a place of contentment that is supernatural. He lives with such peace and joy, and even in those circumstances, he has it. And then he writes this letter to give them his secret. We love a secret. And Paul says, let me share my secret with you. And so we're going to look at that today. And I want to give you 3 ways that we can evict envy from our hearts. That when we sense it start to stir up inside of us, that we can deal with it, that we can master it before it masters us. So let me give you 3. If you're taking notes, you can write down the first one. The first one is resist comparison. We got to resist it. We have to shut the door when it comes up. When we begin to sense comparison come in, we have to resist it. Comparison has been around since the beginning of time, but now with social media, it's with us all the time. And so it's an all the time temptation to compare our lives. We used to have to wait until our 10-year class reunion to compare our lives with other people. But now we can sit on our couch and watch The Office and eat a carton of ice cream and scroll through and compare our lives with people. You know, it's been said that like the grass is greener on the other side, but it used to just be that you had 2 neighbors. Now you can see the backyard of thousands of people around the world. And so how do we deal with this? How do we handle the comparison when we begin to sense it? And what we see is that when we start comparing, here's what won't you see, is that when we start to compare our lives with others, what happens is it only leads to 2 places. There are 2 potential destinations. One is that when we compare ourselves with people who have less, it leads to pride and self-righteousness. But if we compare ourselves with people who have more, it leads to resentment and envy. And the reason that social media can so easily lead to envy, because it's been said we're comparing our behind the scenes footage with other people's highlight reels. We're comparing our normal lives with other people's meticulously manicured and finely filtered and carefully cultivated presentation to the world. And so we're comparing our lives with other people's lives. So that's the reason that so often it can stir up comparison and envy. And have you ever wondered? Have you ever wondered, like, why when we get off social media and why we spend a long session in Instagram and why we're going through, why we never leave going, man, I just feel so refreshed. Like, I just feel so invigorated. Like, I just feel so much better. It's because when we spend a long time in comparison, it's training for being dissatisfied with our lives. When we spend a long time in comparison, it can stir up thoughts of anxiety and discontent and compulsion. It can stir up because we tend to focus in comparison on other people, and we get on this treadmill of trying to keep up. And have you ever wondered how God looks at it? Like, have you ever wondered how God looks and when we're comparing our lives with other people, and he says, no, don't go to them to tell you who you are. Don't use their life to measure who you are and your worth and your value. If you want to know how much you matter, look to the cross. If you want to know how much you matter, look to me, because I made you. I'm the one who loves you. I formed you, and I created you to live fully from your heart. And I've got a plan that is unique for you. And the more you look at other people, the less you see the thing that I have for you to do. The less you appreciate what I have for you. God wants you to live full so that you can be who he's created you to be and do the thing that he's made for you uniquely to do. And I came across a scripture I want to share with you. This is in Psalm 139. Psalm 139, this is David talking about God's thoughts of us. And he says, how precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. I love this. David's saying, God, while I'm thinking about everybody else, God, you're thinking about me. While we're thinking about everybody else in their life, and there's God saying, I am thinking about you. And how can I get you to understand how much I'm thinking about you? Just look at the sand. Look at the beach that you're on. Look at the sand. My thoughts of you are more than all the sand that's in front of you and all the sand that's on that beach and all the sand that's on every beach and all the sand that's on every beach around the world. My thoughts of you are that numerous. So while you're thinking about all the other things and comparing your life, I'm looking at you and I'm thinking of my dream for you and my plan for you and my hopes for you and who I've made you to be. And so rather than look at all those other people to compare, why don't you come to me? Let me tell you who you are. Let me tell you how much you matter to me. And that's where our identity comes from. It comes from our Maker. If we want to know who we are and what we're created to do, it comes from looking to him. And so when that comparison begins to rise up, we get off the treadmill. God says, I've got a path for you, but in order to get on my path from you, you have to get off the treadmill of comparison and get on the path. And then you discover what I have for you. So the first would be resist comparison when you sense it rising up. The second would be, second way to escape, to evict envy, is to celebrate others. Look at Romans 12:15. It says, rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Now, I used to think the hard part of this verse was mourning with those who mourn. But what I've discovered is that the indicator of spiritual maturity is, can you rejoice with those who rejoice? Can you celebrate other people in their success? Can you rejoice with other people when they get the thing, especially when it was the thing that you wanted? Can you celebrate with the person who got the opportunity or the promotion? Can you rejoice with your brother when he got the new car? Can you text your coworker when they crush the presentation? Can you celebrate the person who got the job, got the deal, wrote the book, whose song went number one, got the promotion, especially when it was the one that you wanted? Can you rejoice with those who rejoice? I think that's an indication of spiritual maturity. Because we have a choice. Actually, we can choose one of three things. When somebody else succeeds, we can either say nothing or we can talk behind their back, or we can congratulate them. There's three options. We can say nothing, we can gripe and talk behind their back, or we can congratulate them. One of three options. You just got three options. Now, to congratulate them and to celebrate them, I think sometimes we go, well, I don't really feel that. Like, I don't feel like congratulating them. Oh, I get it. I don't feel like congratulating them. Isn't that inauthentic? Like, isn't that insincere to congratulate somebody when I don't feel it? That's not insincerity, that's maturity. It's called leadership. See, we don't wait until we feel it to congratulate others. We congratulate others until we feel it. See, maturity is doing the right thing even when we don't feel like it. And congratulating others, when we do that, it helps kill the comparison and the envy that's going on in here. And it's powerful. It's a powerful discipline to congratulate other people, especially in the church. Listen, envy can be super destructive in a church. Because we can envy other people in their gifts and in their callings and in their abilities and what they're good at. We can envy that. And envy can tear apart relationships. It can tear apart businesses. It can tear apart families. It can tear apart a church. But it's powerful when we honor one another and we congratulate and we celebrate other people in their giftedness. It's powerful. Because what we realize is that we're not in competition with other churches and other ministries and other pastors. We're not in competition with other believers. We're not in competition. We're on the same team. And so we're not competing with other people, but we come alongside and we serve one another and we serve with one another. Look at Philippians chapter 2. Look at what it says. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. That's where envy begins to grow. Selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. See, that's why it's so powerful when we celebrate another person or when we serve another person. That's why Serve the City is so powerful, because when we serve other people, it takes the attention off of our own needs and puts it on other people's needs, and that's where humility grows. It's when we serve other people, yes, it changes the cities, and yes, it changes communities, and yes, it changes regions, but it also changes our heart. It's powerful to serve. It's powerful to celebrate others. There's this Philippians chapter 1, Paul says that all these people are preaching when he's in prison. He says some people are preaching out of envy, some people are preaching out of selfish ambition, some people are preaching out of trying to stir stuff up for Paul, and Paul said, I don't care why they're preaching as long as they're preaching. Paul's like, I don't care why they're preaching. I don't care their motivation as long as Christ is being preached. And here's what we can take from that verse. Wherever God is moving, we celebrate it. Whenever God is moving in the city, we celebrate. Whenever their lives are being changed, we celebrate it. So with me, whenever like this comparison thing stirs up with other pastors, all right. Whenever comparison stirs up with other churches, whenever comparison stirs up with other gifts, whenever comparison stirs up with other people, can I tell you a thing that I do? I pray for them. And I pray that God would bless them. Because then when they get more of what they have, I realize God was just answering my prayers. But it's hard to be jealous of somebody that you're praying for. And so when you start getting jealous of that person, when you sense envy or comparison rise up, when you pray for them, it's powerful. Because it breaks the yoke of envy. And then you see God answer those prayers. So let me ask you a question. Let's just get real. Whose success have you been hesitant to celebrate? Who is it in your life, maybe at work, at school, neighborhood, family? Whose success have you held back in celebrating? And when you think about it, the issue is not with the other person. The issue is with God. Because God's the one who gave you the gifts that you have. And God has a plan that is for you. But the enemy knows that the more that he can get us focused on other people's lives, the less we live the one that God's given to us. And think about it. If he could get us so discontent that we're running around trying to imitate other people, that would be the thing that would keep us from fulfilling the assignment that God has for us. Because what envy does is it makes you an expert at the goodness of God in other people's lives, and it makes you blind to what God has done in your own. See, envy gives us 20/20 vision of the goodness of God in other people's lives, but it blinds us to the goodness of God in our own. That's why the third way that we evict envy, third way is to express gratitude. Express gratitude. See, Philippians is this thank you note that Paul's writing to the church at Philippi. He's like, thank you for your financial gift to me, because Paul was in prison. And when you were in prison in that day, there was no way for you to be supported. The prison didn't support you. So the only way you're going to eat is if people from the outside, friends and family, send their support and send some food and help you out. And so Paul's writing him a thank you note, but he doesn't just say thank you for your gift. He also says, make sure you give thanks. The verse we looked at last week says, when you're talking to God, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Paul is saying, give thanks to God for what all that he has given you, because what gratitude does in our lives, when we express it, it focuses our attention on how good God has been to us. And so I've got a practice in my life that I do every single day. And the reason I have a practice in my life is the reason I practice things is because I want to get good at them, and there are things that I'm not good at that I want to get good at. And so I practice first and 10. And maybe you've been here before and you've heard this, but it's a powerful discipline and practice in our lives to make a list, first thing in the morning, to make a list of 10 things that we're thankful for. And sometimes it's just stuff like a cheeseburger. And sometimes it's my family. I'm not equating those two things. I'm just saying, like, I make the list. And every day I make the list, and every day I run through those things. But as I walk through the 24 hours before and make the list, it awakens gratitude in my life. And what I've discovered is it's impossible for us to live envious lives when we're full of gratitude. Because gratitude evicts envy and jealousy and comparison. Because when we're looking at other people's lives, we're saying, God, you've been so good to me. I love Mondays, first and 10. Because it's real easy. Because I just make a list of stories from the weekend. And this past Monday on my list was Mike's story. This past Sunday, I got to baptize Mike. And Mike is from Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And he and his wife have been listening online for a year and a half. And in that time, he gave his life to Jesus. And he came down to CrossPoint, Nashville, this past weekend to be baptized. I don't know where you commuted from today, but Sioux Falls, South Dakota, that's something. When he came down after he was baptized, he was getting out. He's like, man, I wish I would have brought a shirt to trade you. I said, what do you mean? He said, I own a bar up in Sioux Falls. I wish I would have brought one of our bar shirt to trade you for this Anything's Possible shirt. We could have worked a trade. Mike, I'm waiting on my shirt. Just send the shirt, right? I'll take the trade. But what God has done in his heart and in his life, and because you give, you're a part of that story. You're part of that story. But we express gratitude. God, thank you for what you're doing here at the church. Thank you for what you're doing in people's lives. Thank you for what you're doing in my life. It's a powerful discipline. And so we say, if I want to evict envy from my life, if I want to evict envy, I got to resist comparison. I celebrate others and express gratitude. But just those three things are not enough. Paul said there's a secret. He said there's a secret. And the secret, Paul gives it in Philippians chapter 4. Let me show you. Philippians chapter 4, verse 11, he says, I've learned to be content whatever my circumstances. So the secret to being content among comparison and jealousy and envy, the secret to be content, I know what it is to be in need and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Paul says the secret, the way that I'm able to do this, the way I'm able to live a content life, the way I'm able to battle against envy and jealousy, the forces of comparison, the way I'm able to have contentment is I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Now this verse, Philippians 4:13, a lot of people quote this verse. I know a guy who uses his motivation on the bench press. He said, I can just rep him out. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. So like 11 reps, that'll help you with that. Now that's not the reason Paul gave us that verse. I mean, use it if you want, but that's not the reason. He didn't give us that verse so that you can run a 4:4:40. He didn't give us that verse so that you can be better at dunking a basketball. He gave us that verse so that we can be content regardless of our circumstances, so that we would know that Christ is our source of strength, regardless of what's going on around us, regardless of what we have or what we don't have. That in a world of comparison, we could say, Jesus, I am more preoccupied by you and with you than anything else in this world. And Jesus, you are my source of joy, and you are my source of contentment, and you are my source of satisfaction. And Paul said, that's the secret. At prison ministry back in Atlanta, at Phillips State Prison, I met a man named Big A. I never asked him what A stood for, but I met Big A, and I remember I was talking with him one day. I didn't ask him a whole lot of questions. I just let him talk. He's a wonderful man, been in for 30 years. And he said, Kevin, he said, here's what I've learned. That you don't learn that Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. He said, you don't know that Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. And Paul said, that's the secret. And you don't have to be in prison to learn it. Paul says, you can know it. That you can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. That by fixing our eyes on him, we find the joy and the satisfaction and the peace that we need. And I want to pray with you and pray for you in that. In fact, I want to lead us into a prayer. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and your hearts before God. And I want to lead a prayer for three groups of people. And then we'll be dismissed. But I don't want you to dismiss yourself before we finish, because there could be freedom in this prayer that your heart is longing for. Maybe you've continued to just kind of push down this thing of envy or jealousy or comparison. Maybe you've never told another person that it's a struggle for you. And hopefully what you hear today is this is a struggle for all of us. And we can't do it in our own strength. We need God's grace for that. So Father, thank you that you love us and that you sent your son to die on the cross so that we could be forgiven. You sent your spirit, same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us. So like David says, search our hearts. Would you search our hearts right now? First group would be, you just ask God, God, is there anybody that I'm envying? Is there a person that I'm just jealous of right now? Is there a person with whom comparison has affected our relationship or affected my heart and is tearing me up? God, I need your help. I can't see it on my own. You've helped me see it. And I can't get over it on my own. I need your grace. So as he brings a name or a face to mind, would you first just pray, God, forgive me. Forgive me of holding on to that. And I just release them to you. I return to you. Pray right now that you would free my heart from envy. And I pray that you bless them. Oh, would you bless them? So that my heart would be open up to receive from you too. And the second group would be those who would say, you know what, I need just an awakening of gratitude in my life. Maybe I've taken a lot of things for granted, my family for granted, my work for granted. I have a place to live for granted. I have food on the table for granted. Friendships for granted. God, we're just saying we don't want to be entitled children. You want an awakening of gratitude in your life? Just pray something like this. Father, would you give me eyes to see your goodness? Would I see that every good and perfect gift comes from you? Would I be able to see the small things and the big things? and give you glory for all of it. And God, would you give me the grace to make a list when my heart needs it to make a list? And if that's every day, to make a list. I pray that it wouldn't be legalism for you, but it would be a path to freedom. And then last, for some that the struggle is for contentment, to be content. And Jesus is the source of strength for that. And maybe today you just need to return to him. Your heart has drifted. You've chased other things that have left you empty. And his invitation today is, would you just come back to me? I'm the one your heart longs for. And if that's you today, if you just want to lift up your hand, just between you and God, I'm not going to embarrass you or make you come up here. You're just saying, God, I'm returning to you. God, I pray for those who have raised their hands and even now are raising their hands. God, I pray that today would be a day of returning. And as they return to you, would such peace and joy and love fill their soul? Would they know how much they are loved by you? And Jesus, would you be their source? Would you be their strength? Would you be their life? Would they experience your abundance in their hearts so that they would live fully? And God, would their life be such a light in the city to show you off? And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to continue the series next week. You're going to want to be back for it. We're going to talk about how do you get past your past. And so we talk about getting over things. Next week, you want to be here for that. You guys have a great week in the Lord. We'll see you back then.